Ready to get seated for this afternoon? Let me start, folks, with two announcements. We're going to have We're going to have a break in the session at 3 o'clock, an hour from now, to get a group photo pack. So that will inspire us to ask Ian 59 minutes worth of questions. The other is that the reception tonight is at Walter's house, which is an easy walk up the hill. It starts at 6 o'clock. If you're not interested in walking, another plan is to go back to the hotel where they'll have a shuttle. And if there's any difficulty with either plan A or plan B, please see Debbie out here and we can arrange to get rides for those who won't travel either of those two ways. Okay, so let me turn the afternoon session over to Hugh, who's going to be our master of ceremonies for the afternoon. Yeah.
Good afternoon. I have the honor to introduce the next speaker. I'm Gahead. He comes from the Canadian Institute of Ocean Science. He's the expert oceanography. I've been working on the field for many decades. She's probably the only one, the only oceanographer in the room that have retired twice. And after two retirements, she's here today to give us her view on how the dissipation, how the mixing affects the ocean processes. So please join me to welcome Anne Gaget.
Yeah. Okay, so on the left are this data, the first data that Tom collected with his new probes in 1972, not very long after leaving here. And it shows velocity structures in association with temperature. And so he made estimates of the dissipation rate epsilon, as you know from the integral under the spectrum of shear velocity. Well, it turned out that Tom's probes were initially met with a bit of a skepticism because some people believed that he was just measuring vibrations. However, the doubts were eventually silenced by results by people like Neil of the Infinite Institute, who were early adopters of Tom's probes. And then I like to think decisively, when Tom and I put two of his probes together with measuring the cross-stream component, a small-scale shear, with a hot film velocity profile sensor, which I inherited from Harold Grant, measuring the axial component of the small-scale velocity. We mounted this on a Kirsten's submersible that the government of Canada happened to own at that time, and we ran it through a large train of very nonlinear internal waves that was released from a sill at 9 mm twice a day. In the very high Reynolds number turbulence that's associated with the very front of that wave train, the velocity sensors, both of them measured very, very clear minus 5/3 subranges. And in addition, which had never, as far as I know, been seen before, noted before, because nobody measured more than one component, is that the ratio of the cross-stream spectrum to the longitudinal spectrum had the expected value of 4/3. So after this, the microscale profiling community sort of entered what I would call the Montesinal period, in which individual groups built their own profilers, they made their own probes, they calibrated their own probes, and they took the measurements of epsilon to many, many regions of the world ocean, including, as we have seen, iconically, the Fiji Ocean, where the Woods Hole group in the mid-80s started being able to make dissipation measurements right down to the bottom. In the early 2000s, this cozy scene was kind of transformed by Rolf Lueck and his Rockland Scientific. They offer essentially turnkey systems, profiling systems, with calibrated probes and, in fact, packaged analysis software for dealing with the data when you get it. So now anybody who has an interest and money can make high-quality profiles of dissipation rate through the full depth of the ocean. So over this is 50 years we're talking about, as Mike pointed out, profiles of epsilon have become the measure of turbulence in the ocean. My primary aim here today is to actually argue that it is beyond time to get beyond dissipation. And there are two compelling reasons for this. The first compelling reason is the undersampling that's associated with shipborne profiling. I first came upon this issue when I was working in the coastal waters of British Columbia and trying to measure the turbulence associated with tidal flows, which are very strong and very, very highly time and space dependent. The vertical velocity in these panels comes from a single Doppler, narrow Doppler beam pointing down, accurately vertical, and shows the development of this front as we traverse it over a mere 3 days, starting at new tides and going towards spring tides. What you can see very easily is that there are very large changes in not only the magnitude of the vertical velocities in this turbulent front, but also their structures, how big they are and how strong they are. Now, if one operates a microscale profiler in an environment like this, these are measurement profiles are from Jim Moore from the vertical velocity and its vertical length scale, and calibrated by these sparse profiles. What you can see is that the profiling rate that you can get is really marginal for actually giving a complete description of this tidal front. Now, I think it's wrong to imagine that the deep sea is any better sampled in space than these tidal fronts. Shipboard profiling to 4,000 meters will take a minimum of a few hours, and sometimes considerably more. Profiles are necessarily taken at random phases of the tide, although they can be sorted after the fact. The profiling itself has to be actually suspended under certain really extreme conditions of surface forcing. And oceanographic cruises only last usually, you know, a month and a half, 2 months, which is good for us, but it's not so good for a complete description of turbulence at any particular site in the ocean. Okay, so undersampling is one problem. The second compelling reason why I think we need to get beyond dissipation is essentially the existence of the turbulent cascade. Turbulent kinetic energy enters the turbulence at large scales. And it, at that point, it has properties that are impressed upon it by the processes that generate it. While that energy is being transferred to ever smaller scales in the turbulent cascade, any information about that process and the characteristics of the large energy-containing scales is irretrievably lost. If you have epsilon, you have no direct information about the processes that are forcing that turbulence. Instead, you have to infer what those processes are. And we've all gotten pretty good at those kind of inferences. However, I'd actually like to argue that it's really time that we started trying to measure the energy-containing scales directly, and do so in a way that gives us the ability to make time-extensive measurements in a particular location. So to illustrate the advantages that will accrue should we do so, when we do so, I'm going to selfishly use my own data. Now, this is from a shallow coastal location just off the coast of New Jersey on the east coast of the United States. And in 2003, I, my wonderful technician, installed what was then a new kind of instrument, a 5-beam Doppler current profiler, with the 5th beam accurately aimed vertical and jetted into the bottom side of the beam. And with this instrument, I set it to sample at a hertz, which is about as fast as we could. And given that we want to do the whole water column, it's on a cabled observatory, so there's no problems with power or data transfer for that matter. Now, what did I think I was going to be measuring when I put this thing out there? I thought, basically, that I would be measuring bottom boundary layer turbulence associated with the tidal and mean flows on this shelf. And maybe occasionally I'd see a little bit of near surface mixing due to, you know, the passage of storms and things like that. What happened was that within the first 5 weeks that we had it out there, we saw this. The top panel is the backscatter from the vertical beam. You can see it gets right up to the surface. You can see the surface going up and down tides. The bin size here is 0.4 meters. And this is what you see is you. Okay, originally you see high backscatter under the surface, and then suddenly it expands to fill the whole of the water column and stays there like that for the whole extent of what is called a nor'easter. It's a typical storm on the east coast of the United States. So you see the wind stress goes up, stays relatively constant, and then falls. surface wave field builds up, remains relatively constant. And if you expand in this area of the with pi back scatter, what you see is instantly identifiable. You can know exactly what you're looking at just looking at this. You don't have to do anything else. What you're seeing is you're seeing full depth linear circulations. So here's the cartoon of, I don't know if you're seeing my whole talk. That's great. Okay, so what you see at the top is a cartoon of the pairs of counter rotating vortices that kept the characterized linear circulations. And what you see in the, this is a three dimensional velocity field we have measured now. What you see is features that are completely consistent with that cartoon. Under downwellings, this is the vertical velocity and blue is down, you get a change in the sign of the cross wind velocity. As you can see, you go from positive negative as you go across this downwelling. And there is also a downwind jet associated with the downwelling, and vice versa for the upwelling.
And how long is the time scale?
It's about 2 hours. 2 hours and 10 minutes. What you also see is that associated with these downwellings is high backscatter emanating from the surface. That's very characteristic of linear circulations measured anywhere else. It's due to microbubbles that are produced by breaking surface waves being advected down, pulled down in these downwellings. What had never been seen before are these areas of high backscatter emanating from the bottom and moving towards the surface in these upwellings, which are broader than the downwellings, characteristically again for linear circulations. This high back scatter from the bottom is due to sediment that's been resuspended in the surface wave boundary layer and is being moved up, some fraction of it, right to the surface in the upwellings of these large scale linear circulations. So these, I call these linear supercells because of their dramatic effect on the horizontal transport of resuspended sediment on these shells. They were not known by the shelf transport community before they was published. And they have, their discovery has fundamentally changed the paradigm of raw resuspended sediment transport on these shells. So that was exciting. But the fact is, I have 8 months of one hertz data 24/7 at this site. Starts in early April and goes through to the end of October. So what we have been able to do with this data is, first of all, give a qualitative description of how the characteristic turbulent structures at this site vary predominantly here as a on an annual basis as a function of annual variations in stratification and wind forcing. But on from that, we have been able to actually produce quantitative estimates that allow you to predict what type of surface forcing will produce what kind of characteristic turbulence. So I don't have time to go into the details of these, but what we have is a linear number, which says how strong the standard stress-driven forcing is relative to wave or linear forcing, and a Richardson number, which is the same ratio for how strong convection is relative to stress. So full depth linear circulations occur down in this range where the stress forcing is way less than the linear forcing, and the convective forcing is way less than the linear forcing. What we also have, which I haven't actually shown, is our records that have all of the characteristics of pure unstable convection, taking the characteristics basically from the atmospheric literature. They have electrical forcing, and you need to know the surface wave field. If you know those two things, you can calculate those two parameters, and you can begin to predict what kind of turbulence is out there. Is it pure supercells? Is it mixed convection and supercell? Is it pure convection? Or is it stress-driven turbulence? It's not stress-driven turbulence. That particular area is completely absent. When you have that ability to predict, then that gives you the ability to parameterize the turbulence on this shelf as a function of the forcing, because these types of things will be parameterized in different ways. So this has really major consequences for parameterization in ocean models. I think that we need similar abilities to do this if we really want to think that we understand turbulence really at any site in the ocean, deep or shallow. There are a lot of challenges, needless to say, associated with this, not only sensors, but platforms. I've been lucky enough to be able to use a bottom as a stable platform, but there aren't very many. Well, there's a lot of bottoms, but not a lot of stable platforms otherwise in the ocean. But I do think that these problems are not going to get solved unless we start thinking about them. Okay, and so finally, if this isn't enough, I want you to think about how it is that we build observations of turbulence into ocean models. And we do that normally by parameterizing the all-important vertical fluxes of, say, temperature and salinity as the diffusivity times the mean gradient. And almost inevitably in models, the diffusivity is the diffusivity. It's the same for temperature, salinity, density, oxygen, whatever. It's the diffusivity. So that's the assumption we make. But is that really true? Is KT really equal to KS? I suggest that there's no real reason to believe that that's true. If we go out and make observations, as Reyes talked about, Mike's talked about, if we go out into areas where we can get double diffusion, we often see some symptoms of double diffusion. And then there is the really unknown effects of differential diffusion, depending upon how strong or how complete, I prefer to think of it, a mixing event is. Excuse me. So potential differences between these two things really do matter, because both of them affect the density. And so they affect the diffusivity, for example, that is in Walter's model of the diffusive thermocline. And in order to illustrate a little bit why that might be of concern, I'm going to use a truly iconic model, which is Stommel's box model of the thermohaline circulation. This is in a fairly straightforward rendition of that, each in which you have two boxes for the equatorial gyre, two boxes for the polar gyre. The upper boxes in each gyre are forced by balancing fluxes of temperature and salinity. The equatorial box gets heated and solidified, and the polar box gets cooled and pressured. And what happens, when you force this little toy model with these steady fluxes, can be described in terms of this ratio, the flux ratio, which is the first order effect of each of those fluxes on density. So, with a diffusivity ratio, now the diffusivity ratio is going to be Ks over Kt, as was defined before, fortunately the same way up. This is the results of the Stommel model, and both of the Kt is equal to Ks in both gyres. Basically, what happens is that you get one of two possible modes. you get a mode with convection in the polar gyre if the heat forcing wins, and you get a mode with convection in the equatorial gyre if the salinization wins. And this model, Scommo's basic model didn't have vertical diffusion, but this model does have vertical diffusion, obviously it has the diffusivity ratio. The vertical transport of density, is in the stratified gyre, and it's really very small compared to the horizontal transports in this model. So what happens to this model when we change this diffusivity ratio? I'm going to change it in a way that the diffusivity ratio in the equatorial gyre is going to be 2. That says that Ks is twice Kg. That's saying maybe I believe that salt fingering is dominant in the equatorial boxes. And in the polar boxes, I'm going to set it equal to 1/2. Say I think maybe diffusive layering or for some reason differential diffusion is particularly apt in that set of boxes. Well, what happens to the Snommel model is really quite profound. Basically, the direct modes, the ones that involve convection, get pushed off to the boundaries of the forcing regime. And the space in between gets occupied by a set of 3 what we've called indirect modes. I don't have time to go into the actual circuit diagrams here, but basically the point to take home is that all 3 of these indirect modes have no convection at all. Both of the gyres are safely stratified. And then finally, I'd like to point out this small, but not vanishingly small, regime of range of forcing, in which under steady forcing, this model actually has no steady mode. Instead, it has a mode in which the equatorial gyre is stratified, and the polar gyre undergoes periodic convection, separated by those periods of stable stratification. Now, the Snommel box model is a toy, after all. But over the years, it's been a very influential toy. Almost every paper you read about the thermohaline circulation, or what is now called the Atlantic meridional or returning circulation, refers to this 1961 paper of Snommel's. And so, as a result, I find it somewhat disconcerting to discover that its modes are so sensitive to what are really observationally differences in diffusivity ratio, which we can't observe. We have no way of knowing whether it's times 2 or 1/2 2. And it turns out if you don't like that set of diffusivity ratios, you can choose ones that are even smaller, even closer to 1, and you still get time-dependent modes, and you get the same modes, but you get a lot more time dependence in the way you get to these modes. Now, vertical diffusion, as I said, is small compared to horizontal transports in these models. And so it takes quite a long time for the effects of different diffusivities to kind of build up. So I don't think we have to worry about this particular problem for example, our climate models that we're trying to predict the next 100 years. But for anybody that's interested in paleoceanography, I think this has to be a concern, because these very small differences, because temperature and salinity affect the density of seawater, can really change what you get out of your models. So it seems that for such long time scales, we really might have to figure out how different are Kt and Ks, and that in turn might require making direct flux measurements in the ocean. I've suggested that we're within striking distance of being able to make direct measurements of the energy-containing eddies. Unfortunately, the flux-containing scales are only a little bit smaller than that. So if we can solve the sensor in the and the platform problems enough to be able to measure the energy containing scales. We can probably measure the flux containing scales too. But how one would put that together with an actual measurement campaign is a problem that the flux measurements themselves, they're a problem that I'm very, very happy to pay to the next generation. And so there's only one thing left to say, and that is happy birthday, Walter.
Scale from large scales to small. This is never true. It's backwards and misleading. Turbulence always cascades from small streams to large.
Really? I'm glad
Komogorov
must be
called Komogorov. Yes, Komogorov was sucked into this G.I. Taylor and L.F. Richardson and John Mumley concept of a cascade from large streams to small. But it's not true. Okay, it goes in the opposite direction. See the journal of personalism.com.
So they usually write the book that for 3D goes from large to small, for 2D turbulence from small to large.
No, for
always. I'm not sure that it always goes.
At least my story is. Okay, you don't have to believe it just because I said. So I'm saying that the turbulence problem is not solved. Also, turbulent mixing problem is solved. And it requires this mechanism of the cascade being always from small scales to large, obeying the laws of universal similarity laws of Komogorov induction.
Let's take the next question, please.
So getting back to your talk, what about Lagrangian-based methods, such as Eric-Saros floats, for measuring correct fluxes? And can that be extended to the ocean material?
I have only ever seen Eric's floats used in the surface mixer. And I think that it's pretty the ballasting of those floats to be neutrally buoyant, they're not going to work. That's why I think he's using them in the upper ocean. They have to be balanced so that they're neutrally buoyant, because otherwise they'll either fall through the water column or rise through the water column. And in order to do that, you have to be sure that as it's moving around in the vertical, it's not encountering very strong differences in density, or else it will, its own motion will be in there as well. So I think that's certainly in the surface layer, they've been shown to do, they can measure fluxes themselves as well. So that, it may be that it would start the surface layer and then see how to, but I don't see how that neutrally buoyant flow technique will work in this direction.
Hi. In response to your first point, I wanted to just highlight some of the work in putting microstructure gliders, microstructure profilers on gliders and instruments like that, Edgar Fair and Matthew Palmer at the MSC Liverpool are kind of entering a new artisanal glider-based microstructure.
Yeah, but there's still microstructure, right?
Yes, still microstructure.
My argument is that I'd like to see us move to
Well, supposedly we are supposed to have a rendezvous with a photographer at 3:00. It's a bit early for that. Are there any general comments or anything that people would like to say at this point? Ralph would like to say something.
Heard in a number of talks this morning that there is strong evidence that the turbulence that matters for water mass transformation is close to the ocean floor. So at least it's a place where you can have fixed platforms, and it's a part of the ocean in terms of mixing and turbulence hasn't been sampled enough. It's probably a part of the ocean. It might occasionally be re-stratified, so to measure the turbulence, you should go back to flux measurements. And we heard that maybe if you're getting there in the atmosphere, they do flux measurements. Come back to boundary layers and measure fluxes that way. It must be used. The technology ready to bottom area you need. Correlation measurement W prime, S prime, W prime, and T prime. If you can do it, how do we do it? That's should happen as soon as we can, because it seems to be an important question.
There's always a challenge with getting W to be up, or diapignal, and but near the bottom, sort of getting... And also getting the power down there to do these measurements. I certainly like working flip for many years because you have stability and diesel engines, and that's a luxury that we have to export, I think, to other places.
But the bottom of the ocean doesn't move, so we have a platform.
That's right, we just need power.
Is there anybody who has good ideas how you do
it? Tim's ready.
Yes.
Yes. It's really doable. We did an experiment about 3 or 4 years ago on NSF sponsorship and did in Monterey Bay 50 meters depth for about a month, doing measurements of UVW, W70, right down the prepared, for example, for the shear power, which is complicated because we have a wave driven down the land, down the shelf, the abyssal ocean, at least we don't have that complication. And providing the determinants, the stratification isn't too strong to drive the scales, the outer scales, down below the sample volume of the instrument. I would argue it's very possible to do those three measurements. So Eric, just send us some money in.
One of the things going on that bothers me a bit is there's a tendency to associate boundary layer turbulence and the turbulence near the bottom boundary of the seafloor with something that's shear driven and associated with the viscous drag of the seafloor and something flowing over it, as in a classical atmospheric boundary layer where you do your experiment at a cornfield and you mow the stubble to just the right height to get a roughness life. And certainly when we've been looking at the boundary layer right down to the bottom off the slope of Tasmania where the tide is shoaling, the largest overturns by far convectively driven by the giant internal tide coming up the slope. And it's not shear driven, and it might not be isotropic, and all sorts of exciting things can go on that will complicate things a bit, but it's still tractable.
Can I have a comment? A comment on the discussion on whether the flux and the turbulence spectrum goes to small scales to large scales. I suggest a compromise, it goes in both directions. It depends on the system you're looking at. Looking at weak turbulence, then you wave interactions with weak nonlinear coupling. You have a source of energy in the middle of the spectrum, and the energy flux goes both to longer scales and smaller scales. So maybe that's a sort of compromise for the two-way.
As the inverse cascade. Use of the term inverse cascade brings with it a $10 fine. When I become emperor of the kingdom.
All right.
That was from small scales to large.
What injects the energy at the small scales, Carl?
As you know from using hydrodynamic phase diagram, you have a critical level coming at the contours, which tells us the beginning of the cascade from small scales to large. So you have two eddies of the same velocity vector near to each other. Then they induce velocities from the velocity that causes them to merge. That's the physical mechanism. And it seems to you get double pairs and they merge together and so on until you find a force like the Coriolis force on the equator or the buoyancy force which causes the turbulence to fossilize.
Okay, again, many of us have just spent the last couple of decades watching the internal tide breaking. It looks a lot like a big breaking wave that's sitting up like that and then it collapses. And how you define that in terms of classical theory, I don't think matters too much. You can just watch it and watch it happen. Peter.
talk about bottom boundary layer and the more similar case or is the boundary layer under CMS where you, you have the same question of tides coming along or in the case of CMS you've got a layering very close to the surface so it is generally more violent variabilities in that boundary layer than you would have on the bottom of the layer, but that makes it an interesting place to study.
That's certainly the case. It's one of the odd pieces of history that the boundary layer under the ice in the Arctic is one of the best classical laboratories on the planet. Who would have thought? And as you go below that, you get to the coldest ocean on the planet. So it's one of the things you just get to run into. Okay, we're a little early in terms of discussions, in terms of actually getting a photographer to show up. So we might as well open the doors and let ourselves out to ventilate a bit and diffuse. But when we actually succeed in producing a photographer, please reconvene. It'll probably be 10 or 15 minutes and we'll get a group photo taken. Thank you very much.